Where is the evidence for the Wolfram Physics project? How would you respond to that?
Well, gosh, I mean, it's not a very common thing that you get to look at the big achievements of 20th century physics and know why they're true. Never happened before. Nothing is even close to that. It's remarkable how much you get from a rather small, you know, from a sort of a small essential set of ideas. There's just huge reach in all these different directions. Now, you know, if you say, do we know it's our model and not model XYZ? One of the things that's interesting is an awful lot of things that have been developed in mathematical physics seem to plug into our models. They seem to be limits of our models. They seem to be, you know, specific cases of our models, things like that. So the idea it's us versus them is not really the thing. I suspect that essentially all of the popular mathematical physics directions, whether it's, you know, whether it's, I don't know, loop quantum gravity, or whether it's spin networks, or whether it's string theory, or whether it's, you know, ADS-CFT correspondence, these kinds of things, they all seem to plug into our models. Our models provide, like, this is why ADS-CFT is true. This is, you know, string theory lives in this particular corner, a particular sort of case of our models, maybe. We don't know that for sure yet. But that's what I think is going to happen. So it's not us versus them. But there are fundamental things about our models that are very different from what's gone before. For example, the idea that space is discrete. And that's a thing that it's kind of amusing if you look at the history, which I have only come to know much more recently, which is, you know, back in antiquity, people were arguing all the time, you know, is the universe discrete or continuous? They would have said, you know, Democritus would have said space is discrete. You know, other people would have said it's continuous, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. They were arguing about it. Okay, then we get, people were arguing about the same kind of thing for light. Then we get to the end of the 19th century, and sort of the big fight was on about molecules. And, you know, was matter discrete or continuous? And it really looked like the continuous stuff was going to win right up until when molecules and Brownian motion and things like that were discovered. And at that point, it's like, okay, you know, matter is discrete. And then, okay, light is discrete. I mean, Einstein, when he's presenting, you know, the photoelectric effect and idea of photons, just comes right out and says, we discovered that matter is discrete. Let's check out the electromagnetic field. Maybe it's discrete too. Gosh, it actually is. At the time, and this is something I didn't know until very recently, at the time, most people believed space was discrete.
Even Einstein, apparently.
Absolutely. Einstein, Bohr, Heisenberg, the whole crowd, they all believed space was discrete. And as I keep on finding out more and more of this history. But what happened is they couldn't make it compatible with relativity. And that was a technical problem. I mean, that's a problem we solve with hypergraphs, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And so they gave up. And so for 100 years, people said, oh, space must be continuous. And when you said, well, wait a minute, space might not be continuous, people are like, that's just nuts. Now, you know, they wouldn't have said that. 100 years ago, people wouldn't have said that. It's a thing which, and it happens in science and other fields, that people develop, oh yeah, you know, for very technical reasons, oh, it has to work this way. And then after a few sort of academic generations go through, it's like, well, of course it works that way. So, okay, is space discrete or not? You know, with molecules, people kind of lucked out that Brownian motion was visible. The question is Brownian motion, is the analog of Brownian motion for space detectable? Is it detectable in our times? And that's a really interesting question. And, you know, we're working on it. And, you know, maybe there are some things to do with black holes that are detailed effects. And maybe there are some things that I have the slight guess that dark matter will end up being a feature of the microscopic structure of space. And that it will be that after we know what it is, everybody will say, how could we have been so stupid? We missed that for 50 years or whatever. But I think, but we're not there yet. So can't say that.
Yeah.
But I think.
I heard a quote from you about dark matter's space-time heat, or the caloric substance of our time.
Yes. Well, we don't know that now, yet, but that,
well,
that's...
Let's imagine you didn't. Let's imagine you knew it. Let's imagine you were able to derive that. Then could you also say, because there's an abundance of evidence that dark matter behaves like matter, so because of that, then could you also say that some of the matter or the matter that we see is also a form of space-time heat? Like, if space-time heat can behave like matter, what is the limit to that?
Right, but okay, heat is a form of energy. Kinetic energy, you know, large-scale motion is a form of energy. It's the same sense, I think, here that particles, ordinary particles, are like large-scale motion. And whereas my guess would be there's a different thing, which is microscopic features of space-time. So, for example, if we look at matter, we are used to macroscopic things happening with matter. Throw a ball from here to there, that kind of thing. There's a big chunk of matter that's moving from here to there. Then we're used to the idea of heat. Heat is a microscopic feature of matter. Heat is not macroscopic. Heat is something about individual molecules. So my guess is that particles are the macroscopic, not macroscopic on our scale, but macroscopic relative to the atoms of space, macroscopic effects in the structure of space. Whereas maybe space-time heat is microscopic effects in the structure of space. And my guess, that's my guess so far, is that that leads to, you know, that will lead to a change in the things we say about the structure of space. And you say, well, okay, one thing to understand, it's a fundamental feature of, well, okay, so Einstein's equations, for example, and the principle of equivalence and so on. In Einstein's equations, you can trade off sort of energy momentum for gravitational field. You can kind of move things around. You say, okay, I've got a gravitational wave. Is the gravitational wave something which is a source of gravity, a source of space-time curvature, or is it just space-time curvature? You can kind of trade off those two things. In our models, that trade-off is more extreme because in our models, everything is just a feature of the structure of space. So these particles are just sort of lumps in space. In traditional general relativity, one distinguishes things which are features of space from things which are sort of matter that exists in space. Now, for example, let's say we made a bunch of stuff out of black holes. Then we would be in the same situation because black holes are, as they're usually formulated, just a feature of the structure of space. So if we were making our sort of, I don't know, our you know, planet or something out of lots of little black holes or whatever, if we could hold them apart and so on, then we have a thing which seems like it's, you know, something that's like matter, but it's really just made of structure of space. By the way, I suspect that there is a close analogy between particles like electrons and things like black holes. They're both kind of persistent structures in space-time, except that black holes, we have normally imagined in general relativity that they're these very big things, whereas we think the particles are very small and subject to quantum mechanics and so on. In our models, there really isn't such a distinction. You can have kind of features of space that are on any scale. And in any case, my tendency would be to think that the concept that dark matter is like matter. I mean, this is always what happens in science and so many other things. The fact that it's called dark matter might be a big mistake. Just like people called it caloric fluid, and the calling heat caloric fluid, the fluid part of that name, was a big mistake, which probably made if people just said it's, you know, but they thought of it as a material fluid substance, just as we now, by the name dark matter, we're thinking of it as matter, and that may not be the right picture. And I don't think that the experimental features, you know, what's known is that it has certain gravitational effects. It's not known that you can pick it up and make particles out of it and so on.
Well, many people are trying to find other models that aren't matter, like how do you modify gravity to reproduce the experimental results.
Yeah, right. So, I mean, one thing about that is that the attempts to just sort of go and hack Einstein's equations and, figure out how that works has not been terribly successful. I think one new degree of freedom that we have that's pretty important is dimension change. And because we don't have the idea that space has to be fixed, 3+1 dimensional thing, that provides kind of a reformulation of general relativity in terms of dimension change rather than space-time curvature. And I think that, although I don't know how it works yet, my intuition is that when one looks at those attempts to parameterize changes to gravity, that it's just like, whoops, we missed that change because it didn't seem natural to us. But as soon as you think about dimension change, a change of a certain kind will be natural, even though, let's say, for example, if you were doing a series expansion, you would never get x to the 1/2 is not something you get through a series expansion. It just isn't, you know, x plus x squared plus x cubed and so on will never make x to the 1/2. And so that's a, you know, it's kind of a, like you've kind of missed that by thinking about things in a particular way. And so I'm sort of guessing that dimension change may be the key to seeing how you get an effective modified gravity, because that's what we're going to end up with. I mean, whatever happens, you may, you know, it's just like we can talk about, you know, when we talk about heat, it's a form of energy. It has certain characteristics that are like energy. And in the end, we'll describe it in terms of the dynamics of energy. And similarly here, this will eventually be described in terms of the dynamics of gravity. It's just, it will be a modified gravity, but gravity modified in a particular way that comes out of the structure of our models.
If you enjoyed that clip, then the full podcast is out right now. You can click around here. Enjoy. Subscribe to Theories of Everything to get notified of upcoming podcasts, as there are new full-length podcasts every week on the topics of mathematics, physics, consciousness, free will, and AI. Thank you to Mark from the podcast The Last Theory, which is on screen right now. Please visit his channel, where he interviews someone named Jonathan Garrard, who, in my opinion, doesn't get enough credit for his work. On the channel The Last Theory, both Mark and Jonathan explain the causal graph, multi-way, Rouliette, spatial graph, branchial space, causal invariants, various other subjects within the Wolfram's Physics Project in their mathematical detail.